Hello and welcome to UiPath Essentials Training, Selectors. In this tutorial, we'll take a look at selectors, a fundamental part of UiPath Studio and automation in general. By the end of this video, you'll know what they are, how they work, how to build your own selectors, and how to debug them when they don't work as expected. To take full advantage of this training, you should be comfortable with the basics. Using recording to generate automations, and manually adding actions to customize workflows. All right, let's dive in. Now, you've probably encountered selectors a few times until now whilst automating. Now, that's because all interaction activities, like click and type, have a selector, and it usually looks like this. But before we go into details, let's talk a little bit about user interfaces. User interfaces, or UIs, such as this one for Notepad, are built using a series of containers nested one inside the other. HTML web pages work in a very similar way. To better illustrate that, we'll use the UI Explorer, available in the toolbar here, and the Notepad app as a test subject. We'll press this button to indicate the element that we want to analyze, and click in the editable area. In UI Explorer, this is the specific selector for the element we just clicked, and on the left, the complete UI tree with all the nested elements, similar to a folders tree. We'll enable highlighting to see the yellow rectangle that indicates the selected elements in real time. Notice that in order to locate the editable field in the Notepad interface, we start from the largest container, the desktop, and go through each subsequent element, the whole Notepad application, the container that holds a variety of elements such as scroll bars, menus, etc., and inside of it, our editable text field. So each folder, if you will, is an element that can contain other child elements. UI hierarchies can go much deeper than the three levels that we have here when the application interfaces become more complex. The selector is the actual full path to the UI element we've indicated, starting from the root all the way to our indicated target, the editable field. To get a better idea, let's see a different app, like this default calendar on Windows 10. In UI Explorer, let's click the Indicate button and then click, let's say, a date. By the way, if individual elements are not recognized, try changing the current UI framework from the settings icon and indicate again. As you can see, it's a bit bigger than the Notepad example. But by default, UiPath tries to optimize the selector by using the first and last containers, and only if needed, a few others along the way. In the top pane, we can see the raw selector, the main difference being that it contains the full path to the target, unlike the final, optimized selector, which can have fewer elements. Checking or unchecking rows here adds or removes them from the final selector below. But let's take a closer look at the final selector too. It is actually standard XML code, containing two kinds of information. First, the element type, and its various attributes. The type is pretty self-explanatory. It refers to the kind of element, window, control, HTML, Java, and so on. Attributes, though, are the real stars of selectors. They're the pieces of information that help identify the desired element. For example, the first row tells UiPath to look for the application with this file name, this class, and this title. If any of these do not match, the element will not be found. Attributes for the currently selected element, or row, are on the right-hand side pane. Just like for selectors, checking or unchecking an attribute here adds or removes it from the selected element. To see how and when to edit selectors, we'll use the Notepad example again. We'll click the Indicate button and then the editable area. If we look at the first row of the final selector, we see it's referring to a window within the application notepad.exe, with the class notepad and the title selectors-test.txt. All these are attributes that are used to locate the window on the screen. So let's try it out. Let's start a basic recording with UiPath Studio and type something in Notepad. All right, let's hit Escape, save the recording, and connect the new block to the start node. If we take a look at the type action, we'll notice that it has this selector, just like in UI Explorer, including the title attribute. So now if we run it, the robot types the text in Notepad after the existing one because we didn't enable empty field. Now that's fine, but if we close the Notepad window and open a new one, the automation won't work. And after 30 seconds, an error pops up. Since this type of problem is almost always selector related, let's take a closer look. As you've probably guessed, the problem is this attribute. It contains the name of the file, so it will only work on this file. Depending on the situation, this might be a bug or a feature. Do you want to type in any window or only in that specific one? Now, in this particular example, since the file name is part of the title attribute, our robot will only type into windows that match all the attributes of the selector, so only in Notepad windows of files with that specific name. If you want to have a more generic selector, one that would enable the robot to type into any Notepad window, we have to remove the title attribute from the selector. If multiple windows match the existing selector, the robot will type into the first one it encounters, so whichever is on top of the others. Now at their core, selectors are just a list of UI elements and their attributes, and UiPath matches them to the existing elements on the screen. If we have two Notepad windows on the screen, and we want to type different things into each of them, their selectors will be nearly identical, except for the title attribute of the first element. But that difference is enough to correctly identify the window and its editable text field. Okay, now that we've seen how selectors work, it's easier to understand the selector editor window. Basically, this is a simplified version of the UI Explorer tool, with only two panes, the attributes list and the final selector. Unlike in UI Explorer, the attributes list here contains attributes for all the folders that make up the selector, not just for a single element. You'll notice that if we check and uncheck some of these attributes in the top pane, they can influence any of the three elements in the final selector. For example, the first three attributes control the first element, the window, and the fourth one controls the second element. These four attributes are just a subset of all of the attributes available for this selector. To access the full list of attributes, click the Open in UI Explorer button and further refine the current selector. An alternative to this is manually editing the selector in the bottom pane. Great, so that's the basics of selectors. But before we move on to more advanced topics like customization and debugging, let us first understand the difference between full and partial selectors. All the selectors we've seen so far are full selectors. Now this means that they contain all the elements needed to locate a UI element, including the top level window. Partial selectors, on the other hand, do not include the top level element because they're enclosed inside a container that provides this context, usually an attach window or open application activity. Other than that, they work exactly the same. Now we've previously discussed about the two recording modes, basic and desktop. When it comes to selectors, it's important to keep in mind that basic uses full selectors for all the recorded actions, while desktop uses partial selectors. Let's do a quick example to see how that works. We'll start a desktop recording and do a simple operation on the default calculator app. We'll exit the recording and connect it to the start node. Now, as you can see, the four click actions are inside an attach window container, So what's the purpose of these containers? They're extremely useful when we want to ensure that all the actions happen in the same window without any interference from other windows. We can achieve that by using the output of this attach window activity as the element's input for the next attach window. Now we'll leave it empty for now, as this method no longer uses selectors, so it's beyond the scope of this tutorial. But to sum up, partial selectors are basically full selectors without the top element, which in this case is inherited from the parent. They're better suited for situations where interference from other applications and windows is likely to happen. Selectors are, generally speaking, an excellent tool for building a reliable automation. Even after application changes or interface updates, selectors will still manage to locate the correct elements because their internal attributes remain intact. Next, let's look at a few techniques for customizing and fixing selectors. As shown earlier in the multiple Notepad windows example, the difference between customizing and fixing depends on what you want to achieve. Let's take an example of a text file. What if the file name changes, or it's automatically generated and includes a date, or we don't know the exact name? In all of these cases, we would need a dynamic selector, because the element itself changes over time. It's not fixed. Luckily, we have a very useful feature to help us deal with this type of limitation: wildcards. Wildcards are characters that you can use to replace the parts of the selector that change or that you don't know at runtime. Now, you might already be familiar with wildcards from their use in Windows File Search, Google, or other similar engines. The UiPath uses two wildcards: the asterisk to represent any number of characters, and the question mark to represent a single character. Let's assume that the name of this text file changes every day to reflect the current date. Now, this means that a basic recording that generates a static selector will not work tomorrow. The solution for that is to simply replace the dynamic part of the selector with an asterisk. Now, the type activity will match any Notepad window with the title status update followed by the date, or followed by any text to be exact. Let's look at another example. We'll do a web automation, since that's where dynamic selectors are encountered most of the time. Starting from the Amazon homepage, we want to check the price for a requested book. Let's say Permutation City by Greg Egan, and get its price from here. Easy enough. If we do a basic recording of these actions, and the data extraction, we get this simple workflow. The problem is that if we run it, after the 30-second timeout, it'll fail. It cannot find the elements, most likely due to a selector issue. Let's have a look. On closer inspection, you can see that the title attribute contains the book name, in this case, Permutation City. So the robot is trying to find a window with this title, but it fails because the title changes dynamically, depending on the search criteria. We could remove the attribute entirely, just like before, but a better option is to replace this dynamic part of the selector with an asterisk. Now, this tells UiPath that there is some unknown text there, after Amazon.com. Of course, we need to do the same for the getText action. So let's test it. Great, it's working. Now, it's very important to understand how wildcards work, because they're used extensively with selectors. And this brings us to another tool that can greatly simplify working with dynamic selectors. Let's go back to the previous Amazon example. We reverted the workflow here to its original recorded version without the wildcards we added later. Notice the book's name in the selector. Also, the browser is on a different search page, so the workflow would fail if we'd run it right now. In order to fix this, we'll go to the selector editor for the type action and click the Attach to Live Element button in the top right corner. Then we'll simply indicate again the element that the robot is trying to identify, but failing to. In our example, the search text field. UiPath will compare the initial selector with this one, and will try to build a selector that works for both situations by replacing the non-identical parts with an asterisk. It's pretty handy, wouldn't you say? Alright, finally, let's take a look at how to use one last and special attribute, the index. Its main use is to tell UiPath to pick the first, second, or nth element in a container. Let's see a quick example. In the Notepad app, we want to click on the fourth element in the font list. We'll start by adding a click action and indicating the Calibri font. If we look at the selector in UI Explorer, we can see that the font name is used as an attribute, so the robot will click on it regardless of whether it's the fourth or not. Now generally that's a good thing, but if we want to always click on the fourth font, irrespective of its name, we must remove this Calibri attribute. But watch what happens when we remove it. UI Explorer automatically adds an IDX or index attribute to the element. Let's try it out. And there it is. One last point to keep in mind about the index attribute. Sometimes the index appears in selectors when we actually want to locate a specific element, not necessarily the nth element like in the previous example. Now that's a sign that the target UI element doesn't have enough specific attributes to make it uniquely identifiable, and it relies on an index to specify the correct element. Even if it works, that makes the selector less reliable. You should always try to add other attributes to avoid using indexes. And that concludes our Essential Selectors training. So let's recap. We started with the basics of UIs. All user interfaces are built using elements in containers, usually within other containers, kind of like a Russian nesting doll. UiPath uses various attributes of these containers and elements to find the full path to the correct element. Now, since these attributes are sometimes dynamic, we can use wildcards to ignore the dynamic parts, or the very handy attached to live element that automatically does that for us. We also saw how to pick the nth element in a list using the index attribute, and how that is sometimes a sign that the selector might not be very stable. And all that can be applied to full as well as partial selectors in activities like Attach Window or Open Application. Make sure to check out the Advanced Selectors video for a more in-depth look at special activities for locating elements like Find Image, Find Element, Get Attributes, and others. And we'll see you soon!